Okay, I think we'll start. Anders will get the water. My name is Tore Hagen. I work for Tomra, which is making pantautomater or reverse vending machines, as they're called in English. But I just started there, so most of the what I'm going to talk today is about my work at Western GECO. And I'm going to talk about microservice architecture and how it's sort of used in embedded Linux and with FreeRTOS. Yes, shortly what Western GECO is doing. It's a company that's doing seismic acquisition. So they have a boat, and then they have a lot of long cables behind it. They're like 12 kilometers long, and maybe 10 of these cables. And then you shoot off an air gun, and then you try to sort of find out how the subsurface looks like. And you get an image like this. So that's sort of in this context, this work has been done. What I will cover, what is microservices, how they can be used in embedded system, and some practical examples. Layered architecture. So for enterprise software, this is sort of a typical thing. At some point, they have some database and need to store something. Maybe they have a GUI, and then you have an application. And often they start off as a small project on the side, or someone is sort of, okay, we're going to make something. And then after a while, of course, it looks like this. It just grows and grows and grows and grows. And of course, that means it's becoming sort of unmanageable. So then somebody say, okay, let's make microservices. So what we're doing then is we're saying that instead of having one big application, now we have a lot of small services. Each service provides some functionality, and then the services communicate with each other, and then we per se make the whole thing we did over here. So in Schlumberger, for instance, they have a tool to look at a 3D modeling of the subsurface. That's a Windows application like this. And of course, that's okay in 2000. You buy just a more and more expensive PC, x86, and you get along. But of course, still then it takes hours to do processing. And of course, everyone who knows about cloud today say, okay, I want everything in the cloud. I want to rent 50 servers on Google and run the job in 10 minutes. And of course, if this is your Windows application, you're fucked. So basically, that's like a way, okay, if we divide into services, then we can start moving services to somewhere else. And there are some principles in microservices. Loosely coupled services. Yeah, so it should be everything. I mean, have anyone ever seen any notes saying tightly coupled services? No. So they should, of course, be loosely coupled. They should be fine-grained, meaning they should just do sort of one small thing. Communication is lightweight, meaning small overhead, so you try to sort of minimize, so it's sort of quick to do the communication and you want to minimize any overhead. It should be able to run on multiple servers. It makes it a lot easier for you to scale. It also makes it easier to handle any downtime on servers because you can have several of them running. Services can be developed independently. So of course, when you have them divided up, it's they more loosely coupled and it's easier. So your team in Algeria can take this one, this team in Belgium, and then the team in Canada can do the C service. And they can be deployed separately. So of course, that's of course if you do it to the full extent, meaning that if you do it, then your interfaces has to be version controlled so you know what you're doing. And they can be easier to test in one sense, since you can test them independently. At the same time, it can be harder to test if you want to test the whole thing, because you can have a lot of different combination over the different services, and you sort of test one set, but of course you don't know all the different combinations that might be out there in the field. So is this really new? And of course it's not. Everything in software is just reinventing. So it looks a little like the Unix philosophy. Make each program do one thing well. So that's the same here. We have one service, it does one thing well. And in Unix, you want to expect the output for every program to be the input of another one, which is basically piping. Of course, in services, you can just plug them randomly in together, but at least they should have a well-defined interface, so if you push something into it, it should get what it gets is what it handles. It also, at least in the embedded software context, look a lot like something called active object design. And that one says that you'd use a lot of async communication, and that if you have sort of a group of code, then you do all your requests is handled by one thread for each object. This isn't necessarily a C++ object, but it's a sort of a group of a code. And they have a public accessible interface. So this is also very similar to what we're gonna see later on. So the embedded system I'm gonna talk about. So this here, central system, this is running on the boat you saw previously. Then out in the sea, there are a lot of these concentrated units hanging behind each other. Basically, their job is to take sensor data and send it back to the central system. Yeah, they have, there's a power supply connected to it, feeding power to the sensors. And there's a steering unit with wings to control the position of the cable. Linux implementation. So we say we don't have services, we have daemons, which is basically the same thing. And then we say that every daemon can have one or more threads. That's sort of not any requirements on that one. They all of them have a queue, so anyone can send anyone anything to anyone. And they can send messages to one or more places. Everyone has a status, which basically is information about your current state. So if you, for instance, are the daemon responding and responsible for sending sensor data, it would be natural to put in how many packets I have received, how many I have sent, what is the server I'm connected to. And then it's easy to debug, and it's also useful information. And then we have logging. So this is normal basic logging. You have a timestamp and some information, and you have different levels. And then to make a system, you just have several of these daemons. You connect them together and send messages. And if you need to, you can read the status of somebody else. So now we're gonna make a little sort of practical example. How do we divide it up? What do we actually do? So here is the concentrated unit running Linux. It's the power supply, the central system, and the sensors. So there are sensors connected, but of course they need to be booted up and started. And in our case, they were actually just running a bootloader, so we would need to download the application every time we started up. So then the central system creates an XML message and sends it to an XML daemon. And the XML daemon's only task is to receive XML, change it over to some internal binary format, and send it on. It's also responsible in the other direction to taking some binary information and send it to the onboard system in XML. This is fairly easy to test even on your desktop, because it's a standalone application, doesn't use any OS thing except for a socket. And then you can just take a file and or you may need it to read a file with XML and then test that the output is correct. So it basically will receive a command and then send it to the boot daemon, because it's a boot command and it has a routing sort of table where to send things. The boot daemon thinks, okay, then I need to power on the sensors. So it just sends a message to the power daemon. Of course, if you power something on, then you would like to know if it's power on or off. And then there's a little sort of, I mean, one option would be that I would power it off and then I would read back and wait until it has powered on. The problem there, of course, is that if I'm testing this in the lab, I don't have this power supply. Then I have just the lab power supply. So therefore, we said, okay, I turn it on. I hope it goes on, because it really, for me, it doesn't really matter if it actually was turned on or not. What's important for me is if the sensors are there. So the sensor gets powered. There is a hardware layer. And that hardware layer will basically find out all these sensors will get an address because they're on a network. And that will be resolved by the hardware. So then we have a MUX daemon. This one has a driver down to the lower layer. And basically, it's all the information that is coming from these sensors it looks at. And some of the information is related to booting. So it says, OK, it's boot information. Then I send it to the boot daemon. Some of it is sensor data, in case it would be going to somebody responsible for publishing the data to the recording system on the boat. So at some point, we turn on the power, or at least we hope we turn it on. And we wait for messages, and then we see that, okay, the number of sensors has now stabilized at some reasonable number, because we have some idea how long this takes. And then I just send a message to the command daemon. Command daemon, it gets a command, it sees it to this sensor, it creates it into the format used on this lower layer, and sends it out. There is some hardware thing here to do acknowledge of messages. So this one will send a message. If it's acknowledged, it will throw it away. If it's not, it will retransmit it up to 3 times. So it doesn't guarantee that it's delivered, but at least it sort of gives some better reliability. And of course, when we boot this, basically we push down the image. We ask all the sensors to boot up. And then what they report back is either the application running, or maybe they're saying that there's a CRC on the image I received. In which case, we know, OK, then I'll just download the image again and do that a few times to get the whole system up. And of course, we do things. If you're sitting on the boat, you would like to get some feedback. So basically, they are continuously updating their status. So if you're on an onboard system, you ask it to boot. Nothing happens. You can go in and you can say, OK, the power is off. And of course, that could be, in most cases, it's probably because the power supply is broken. But at least you can get feedback. And of course, if everything works, the feedback is not so interesting. But especially when you're doing hardware out in the sea, rough conditions, there's a lot of hardware failures which you need to debug. Another thing with this design is it's easy to swap out things. So when we started the project, we didn't have that much time when we were doing this one. We had the sensors, they were coming in, they have a new designs, so we need to get them up and running because we need to find out if they work. So this boot daemon was sort of, it would just start here, go to the end, and that's it. So especially it would boot the sensors and say a report, it's booted, they're okay. If you turn off the power, it would still say, yes, I have all the sensors, they're okay. So we said, OK, that's not the behavior we want. We wanted to dynamically explain us what's out there. And we found out it wasn't so easy to tweak the current application. So we said, OK, we're just going to make a new one. And the design here is that you have a status and you have queues. So we can just write a new one, and you can just put it in there, meaning that everyone else, they don't know if it's this daemon or the other daemon. So we would develop the version 2. We could just stop the current one, start up the new one, and sort of get it to a stable level. And then when we shipped the software, which we did regularly to the boat, at some point we would start number 2, but we'd still ship number 1 also. We wouldn't start it, but at least we knew that then it would be easy to make a fallback. Some implementation details. We did send and receive message via Unix socket. So we didn't foresee any need to have any running the services on different machines. It's not the level we worked on. It's fairly easy. You create a socket, say it's Unix type, and they are datagrams. So the good thing there is if you send them, you either get a complete message or not. Because in the beginning, we were using pipes, and then you put bytes on the pipe. When the pipe gets full, you might have sent half a message. Then somebody starts reading, and you mess up the synchronization. It's a Unix family. And then you give it a connection name, which is a string, meaning that all the queues, they have a name, which is a string, which makes it fairly easy for anyone to say, okay, I'm going to talk to boot daemon, then I just get the boot queue. And you bind to it, and then either you can receive from it, or you can send to. The message is binary C structures. So, of course, that means we need to update all the applications at the same time. But this is an embedded system, so in our case, that's not a problem. Status, yes, so everyone had a status. We just did that with shared memory. And that's even simpler. You just call shared memory get. You get an ID. There's a key and a size. And then you get a shared memory attached, and you get a pointer. So there would be like one people, well, no, not one people, one service or daemon that would get the shared memory in write mode, and everyone else would get it in read mode. And they are just C structures, so you just cast it, you can read it. Logging, var log boot log d. So every application had have a file, and we started off with syslog. But this is some time ago, and then actually at that point, syslog at least couldn't have more than X number of services. But we had more than that, and then we had like, okay, two services logging to the same file. Also at that time, syslog would actually print the time in a sort of a text format, so you would get stuck on 1 second boundaries. And of course, we wanted milliseconds, because if you're looking at logs and things happening fast, so. But that's, I mean, writing to a file isn't the most difficult in the world. Yes, we have helpers. So there's a dump and the name of the application. You just double tab. So the sort of what they do is to print out the current status of the daemon. So that's sort of basic debugging, because there's a lot of that in a distributed large system. You can have some options. Maybe you only want to get out part of the information. We also added the comma-separated value format that came out at some point because we want to do EQ testing. So you want to take this unit, run it for 2 days in temperature cycling, and then, of course, you would like to know what is the current and temperature. And instead of trying to dump something large and then parse it afterwards, we say, okay, we'll just make a binary format of it. So then every 10 seconds, you just call dump booty dash dash CSV and attach it at the end of the file. And then, of course, the electrical engineers and mechanical are super happy. They can put it into Excel and they can draw whatever they want. They don't need to bother us with parsing. There's a command boot something, and that's used for sending commands to daemon. So we saw that the XML daemon received a boot command in XML format, converted it into a binary. In this case, we could type command boot daemon dash dash boot section network, and maybe put in the argument that you want it on the front side or the tail side. They also, we could, I mean, so it's the normal actions, but we also have some debug functionality. So for instance, there's a synchronization daemon keeping clocks in sync. We could ask it to jump the clock 2 hours, for instance, and then we can see the behavior of the rest of the systems. Yes, we had a launcher. So all the daemons, they are launched by a launcher daemon. And you could maybe use systemd, that wasn't available at that time, but there were other ones also available. But for historical reasons, we had a launcher, so we just reused it. Was fairly good. Well, it's actually very good, at least for our need. It's restarts daemons if they crash, and if they crash too quickly, it will kill them. It also monitors CPU usage and the memory usage. You could, of course, have done that as a separate application. But basically what we did is we start up, and then after 30 seconds, every application, we see how much memory they use, and we say, okay, this is your baseline. If you use twice as much, okay, so maybe it's a little sort of notice thing. If you use 10 times as much as you did, then they'll kill you or basically restart you, and then they should run on. And for instance, we had one daemon, that this XML daemon, that crashed after 21 days. Because there was a memory leakage there. Useful. There's a fly. Philosophy we had. We said that failure in one daemon should not affect the other daemons. So if you're sending something to somebody and they're not there, or they're crashed or anything, it shouldn't affect you at all. And you should not rely on the existence of anything other daemons or statuses. So if you start up, you're sending something, they're not there, you don't care. You might not be able to provide your complete functionality, but at least you should still be up and running. You can do it later on. If your status is not there, you ask for it, it's not there, okay, I'll ask for it later on. This makes it the startup, for instance, of application very easy, because the order doesn't really matter. In the beginning, we weren't really there, and then you needed to start them in any one order, and sometimes one daemon would be a little quicker or slower than the other, and then the one of them would crash, and yeah. So that's very useful. That was the Linux part, yeah. So now I'm going to talk a little about this FreeRTOS part down here, which is a steering device. Yeah, I thought I had a picture. Well, I have. We'll get it later on. So let's just take the... As you see, the picture looks very similar to the other one. We don't have... So in FreeRTOS, in Linux, you have processes and threads. In RTOS, you only have tasks. And the ones we have, they're not restartable. We start them, and they run forever. If something crashes, then the whole thing crash. We send messages or small tweets. So you just allocate the tweet from a pool, and then you send them to someone else. It's very similar to the old ones. We have a logger. They are actually interchangeable. So in most cases, what we log is like a message log. So we write to the log. It's sent to this concentrator unit and put on the file system there. So you can just log in and see what has happened. But in some cases, you are maybe debugging something that goes very fast, or you're just debugging the interface to the Linux system. And then you can just plug in a serial logger instead, so you can get it out on the serial port. Yes, what are we doing with this one? So it's a steering unit. So it's looking something like this. So on the cable, out in the water, you attach two wings. The main functionality is to keep the depth of the wing. The second part of it is to actually be able to steer it sideways. So this thing, this is the steering unit. It has a motor. Actually, there are two motors, one on each side. And it has a set of sensors. So, communication. There is a communication task. This here is just a serial UART. There's a start tag, so it will wait for the start tag. It will get one of these messages. There's a length and CRC. And then basically, when it's a complete message, it looks at the ID of the message, and it has a lookup table and says, okay, it's going to that queue or that queue. Yes, we have a motor. So there, of course, we have a motor task. And the level of this one is fairly simple. We say, okay, left wing 5 degrees, right wing 7 degrees. And it will run until it gets some new commands. We have sensors. So like depth sensor is very important because we want to steer at a certain depth. And then we use accelerometer because you need to know the tilting of the unit. And like the depth sensor, you don't need to pull very often because it's fairly slowly moving. So you can pull that once every second or something. But we have an accelerometer, and of course, if you have something that's turning, it's not very constant. Another thing is that this is in water, so it's shaking. So this is pulling like 500 times a second. And actually, we have several of these sensors, so it's sort of is going very quickly. So instead of like sending our position every time we have a new position, which be like maybe 500 times a second, we just put the latest position in the current hour status. So everyone who's interested in position or the unit can read it from there. And then of course we need someone to steer. So if you're going to steer, then you need an aim point. So somebody will tell you this is your desired depth and desired side direction. You read out the current position. So then you say, okay, we are here, we want to there, then I want to put wings like this. And then you just tell the motor, go to that wing. And then the motor, of course, also return back the current wing. Because if you go, sometimes there's a delay, so we'd like to know what is actually the current wing at this position, and then you have a control loop. Yeah, of course, we want to publish status here also. Somebody wants to know what is actually the this thing doing, so we need the position of the wings, we need to know, especially on the motors, you would like to need to know how long they run for instance, for quality. And it's the same pattern, you have a status, there is somebody else, which is that's deciding that it's time to publish. The publisher takes the status, creates a tweet and sends it to communication and sends it to the constant unit. And then there is of course a service there that takes this information and sends it to the central system on board the boat. Implementation details. Yes, we have fixed size messages or small tweets. So they're just, you allocate, you get a tweet, it's 256 bytes and that's it. It has an ID, there's a source or destination on it, because actually we don't only have one, there are several CPUs here, and we also reuse the architecture in a later project, so you need to know actually to do some routing. And there's a length indicator. And you just allocate a tweet from the tweet factory, and if you receive it, you need to free it up. We are using C++, so basically FreeRTOS, they provide a queue. Hello, yeah. And then we just have a wrapper around it. So normally we just allocate and receive a pointer to tweets. So I allocate a buffer, I get a pointer, then I just send the pointer on the queue and the other one, so you don't get any copying of any of these messages. And the only thing we do when we allocate is we allocate it. If we get it, we do what we should do. If we don't get it, we don't do anything and we just ignore it. Because there are some error handling at the bottom, for instance, that say, okay, this is the last message, or you ask for something and we're empty, then I'll write it into Flash or something, because now we're gonna die soon. The queue, yes, there's a transmit side and a receive side of the queue. We didn't do that in the beginning, but it's actually turned out a little easier, because often you need to know about three queues. It is good to know which queue is actually I'm gonna read from and what are the other ones I'm gonna send to. Status publisher, yes, periodically sends status to Linux CPU, and we used its tweets. We used both on the Linux side and on the FreeRTOS side. Logger, that sends to Linux on the serial port. So it basically, every time you log, you allocate a tweet, put in this, do an sprintf into the tweet, and then send it to the CPU, Linux CPU. That's it, conclusion. Microservice principles, they can be used in embedded software. You need to tailor your usage for your need. And you don't need to go all in. So, I mean, we went for Unix sockets because we know that we're never gonna do this on several CPUs. But at the same time, what you do in your application is as, okay, I'm asking for a queue. If it's actually Unix socket be needed or we change it in TCP, it doesn't really matter. That's it. Any questions? Yes.
What are some new problems you got from doing this?
I really don't know if there's any drawbacks.
We could maybe say it started as a model.
Yeah, okay. I was lucky, I didn't participate the first 2 years. So in the beginning it was, I think they just debated it, but was it in the beginning it was at least larger things, and it wasn't, they weren't like decoupled correctly. So you need to start things in the correct order and all those things. And then we had a lot of intermittent problems. And I see even when I started in Tomra, I know, which I haven't experienced yet because I haven't worked long, that they have some issues there that they need to start things in the right order. And then that sounds a lot like the problems we had some years back. And it's normally way good to just spend the time and do it, because suddenly you get a faster CPU and you get new problems, which is really just been there all the time. Yep.
In the ML device, do you have any, more latency or overhead? Because you change the design to the
No, well, we didn't really have any CPU constraints. We had a lot of memory constraints. We only had 32 kilobytes and 96 on one of them. So memory was the biggest constraint for us. Using FreeRTOS, I think, was 4K or something. The overhead, you could argue we probably had fewer tasks. I think a task which didn't do anything was 256 bytes. So that's not so much. So if you take 10 extra tasks, it's 2.5K. So, okay, it's 10%, but 10 tasks, it's quite a big sort of, because some tasks you need already, so. And of course, we don't use complete set of C++. We don't have standard libraries, they're way too big. We don't have exceptions. We only had classes. Yeah. No. All memory allocated in the main routine. We create all the objects, and the only memory you have is the pool you can allocate from. Okay, keep on smiling. Thank you.